Okay, so you might be debating right now whether to use set interval or request animation frame for what you want to animate, but I'm going to go ahead and throw one more option in the mix. You see, in Chrome, Firefox, and IE10 Plus, there's actually a way in CSS to make animations without writing any JavaScript at all. Let's comment out the code we just wrote and try it for the Oh No's animation. Just put a big multi-line comment around all of that. So we start by adding a style tag to the page and then adding something that looks like a CSS rule, but is actually our animation definition. So we write keyframes and then a name for our animation, get bigger, and then curly brackets. To do a simple animation that goes from one state to another state, we'll define from and to states. Inside from, we'll write what the starting CSS property should be. And remember how we set it to 50 pix at the beginning. Inside to, we'll write what the end property should be. And here, maybe it was 300 pix is what we ended at, remember? Now that we've defined an animation, we need to tell the browser what element should actually use this animation. So we'll add a normal CSS rule for Oh No's. And inside here, we specify the animation name, and that's get bigger. And then the animation duration, 3 seconds. Depending on what browser you're in, some of you right now might be thinking, whoa, sweet, it's working. In other browsers, though, like Safari or Chrome, it's probably not working. That's because of something called vendor prefixes. Sometimes a browser decides to support a fancy new feature, but they put a vendor prefix on that feature to indicate that it might change later. And this is just their browser's attempt at the feature. To make this work in Chrome, if it's not already, we have to replicate everything we just did and stick WebKit in front. So we need to replicate this part and put dash WebKit dash here. And then here, we'll replicate this and put dash WebKit dash dash WebKit dash. Whoa, sweet. Now it's getting bigger for every browser. And hopefully, by the time you watch this talkthrough, those vendor prefixes won't be necessary. But it's good to know that they exist because you might need to use them for some other feature one day. There's also one more way in CSS to make animations, and that's with the transition property. It tells the browser how to transition smoothly from one property to the next. Let's say that we want the font size of the time left to get bigger when you mouse over it. We could do all that in JavaScript by assigning an event listener for the mouse over event, then using request animation frame to increase the font size property each time. But we can also do that entirely in CSS. Let's think, how would we normally change the font size to be bigger when hovering in CSS? We can do that with a hover rule. We say hash countdown hover and then font size 150 pix. Okay, and now we just need to tell the browser to transition the font size property, how much time to transition it over, and what timing function to use. So we say transition font size 1 second linear. Now, you should pause the talkthrough and try hovering over the text to see what happens. If you're in Chrome, Firefox, or IE10 Plus, then it should get bigger smoothly. And you don't need any vendor prefixes for this technique. There's a whole lot that you can do with CSS animations and transitions, and browsers are pretty good at rendering them quickly. So I encourage you to explore both of them a lot more.